In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Thank you guys for inviting me, and thank you, Abuna Daniel, and everyone here. Short summary about myself. I will make it very short. 43 years old. Married. 4 kids. The oldest is almost 12. Twin girls, so a girl, a boy, twin girls. And the last was not even in the plan.
Wow.
So just take care. And a pharmacist, born and raised in Egypt, lived 8 years in the Gulf region in Dubai as a in pharmaceutical marketing and sales. Called for priesthood here 2005. Did a master's degree in family counseling, marriage and family counseling, and serving in Orange County, San Berlin, and the Three Holies. I think this is it's too much. So, relationships. I don't know if any of you have any degree in counseling or psychology, but they call this master's, the MFT or marriage and family therapy, this master's in relationships. This is the main thing, the whole that encompasses the relationships. And the more you dig more, after 4 years of it took me 4 years to finish the master's, the more I realized that I'm just scratching the surface. It's very, very big and very challenging sometimes, but there is a lot of hope and a lot of science and a lot of work that has been done that is helping really couples who are to enrich marriages and also to for couples who are struggling that they overcome this. But I will tell you before we start. Think of that we have 3 bottles, okay? The first bottle has water and oil in it. Second bottle is having Italian dressing. Third bottle is having mayonnaise. Are you there? The first bottle is having what? Water and oil. Second bottle? Italian dressing. Third bottle? Those are the 3 types of marriages. The first bottle is water and oil. How long you need to check the water in the oil bottle that they will mix together? They will never mix. They will never mix. You keep shaking them. Have you been to IKEA? There is a place that when they are stressing some of the chairs to prove that the chair is very strong, they keep pushing the chair and going back. And it keeps doing this forever. If you kept checking the bottle forever, once it's settled, once you leave it, they will separate the oil ups and the water is down. The oil and the water are the man and the husband and the wife. So what is the Italian dressing? The Italian dressing is water and oil mixed together but all over the place. And in order to do an Italian dressing, from a pharmaceutical point of view, the cream or the oil or the lotions, they are all water in oil or oil in water. Do you know the difference between the cream and ointment? When you put the cream on your hand and you wash your hand, you put your hand under the water, the cream will be wiped out. Because it is water, oil in water. So outside is water. And you are putting water on it, it will be washed out. If you put ointment, so more serious diseases, they use ointment because it is water in oil. So when you put water, you flush it with water. For how long you need water to flush the ointment, it will never flush the ointment because the ointment will still be there because it's an oil. The water inside of the oil, so water drops on the ointment, the oily surface will be slippered and will never. So how to bring the oil and the water together? We will not go technical, but there is a material called substance called surfactants that if you have a grease on your countertop and you put on the grease water, it's not going to be washed anyway. But you, when you add soap, so the soap literally it decreases the surface tension of the grease and let the water and the soap gets and it is washed out. So the soap is a, they call it surfactant, which is, it helps bringing the tension in the oil and in the surface tension of the oil and the water closer together so as it will be white. So they put surfactant in oil, in lotions, in ointment, in mayonnaise. It's blended. You don't know, or you don't, there is no surfactant in mayonnaise, but it is oil and water together. Think of the third option as a lotion, any lotion. White lotion, it is oil and water, or water and oil, and they are fully homogeneous. You cannot separate the oil from the water, and you cannot see them, unless you keep this lotion, put it in direct sunlight for a long time. Too much temperature, it will separate. You will find the lotion, the water is separate from the oil, and now they are separated. Back to the three bottles. Water and oil, it is coupled without the work of the Holy Spirit. Even if we are married in the Coptic Church, receiving the Holy Spirit in the sacrament, but pretty much we are not letting the Holy Spirit work in us. The Italian dressing, it's water and oil, it's hanging in there, but they are not, you can see the water, you can see the oil, they are blending, but they are not that homogeneous, they are not that one. The last bottle, which has the lotion or the mayonnaise, all of those are water and oil. Or the ointment or the cream, it has the power of the Holy Spirit working in this couple, and they are one, they are homogeneous, they are united. So we need really to be aware that it is very challenging to bring the water and the oil without the Holy Spirit. It's very, very tough. Without the work of God inside the family, it's very tough. It's very, very tough. We're adding the stressors for everyone, it's even more tough. So, seven principles for making marriages work. There is a guy who has been doing research on couples for the past 45 years. MIT math major. His roommate is a psychology major. They bonded together. They kept sharing books and stuff. So the guy who is math major got into psychology because of his roommate. He switched from math to psychology, and he became one of the most famous couples therapists in the whole world because of his research for 45 years. And he had something very, very weird he did with couples no one did ever before, which is videotaping couples. So they have something called Love Map in Seattle. He's based in Seattle. He goes, people are signing up in the Love Map, in his studies. They go, they check in on Friday night till Sunday night. They stay in those apartments. Those apartments, there's videos and cameras and audio recording everywhere. There is no recording in bedroom or the bathroom. There is anytime there is a fight or an argument, nurses are stepping in. They take blood pressure, pulse, analysis of blood picture, and also urine. He has been doing this for 45 years, and everybody, you will think that this is crazy. I mean, those are human beings; they are not animals, but. This brilliant guy said, you know what, he is saying, I believe that human beings are all the same. I believe that when we record, we will have a document that will prove whatever thesis or whatever direction we are pursuing, because it is evidence-based. It is not that, okay, if couples used a better communication, they will be happy. You can study this as a thesis, or you can put this as a goal to study. Better communication will make them happiness, or will bring happiness between the couple. And you can assume this. But he never did this. He said, no, let us videotape, let us record, and let us revisit and discuss more later on what's happening in the relationships. And he came up with this book, Seven Principles for Making Marriage Work, best New York bestseller book. What his name is John Gottman. What is really famous about, anyone have heard about John Gottman? What is famous about John Gottman is he watches, all is videotaped. So he watches 5 minutes of a videotape of a fight between a couple, and he predicts the rate of divorce with 95% accuracy. And this is what he is famous for. Because the mind of the MIT math, plus the psychology, plus the videotaping, and this is what he's really, really famous for. And so we'll go through the principles that he mentioned in this book, but I will start with a couple of true and false statements. So the primary goal for those helping married couples should be to reduce conflict in the relationship. So when you seek marital therapy or couples therapy, this is the primary goal. True or false? No, it is to repair, and it is repair and taking influence or accepting that each other is influenced by the other. Expression of anger has been associated with increased marital satisfaction. True or false? It's a bit debatable, but while it is associated with lower marital satisfaction, it is also associated with higher satisfaction over time. It's how you express the anger, how you express the frustration that makes the difference and help both the couple to understand more. Unhappily married couples underestimate the positivity in the relationship by as much as 50%. It's all about being negative, criticism, pinpointing mistakes. So unhappily married couple underestimate the positivity in the relationship by as much as, so 50% of people who are living a miserable marriage, they are saying being positive is not a big deal. Gottman named this negative sentiment override. So, you know, in the relation between the positive and the negatives, in our regular conversation, how many times you are saying something positive, how many times you are saying something negative? 10 to 1? 10 positive or negative?
10 negative.
10 negative to 1 positive. You are not that far. It's 25 to 1. 25 negatives to 1.
This is what people are like. This is what they
are. This is when you record phone calls or record conversation with people. You know how much positive you need to overwrite one negative? So in reality, we are giving 25 negatives to one positive. And every one negative, we need 5 positives to override the negative. So pretty much, we need to take whatever positive we have and multiply it by 2 million to take away the negativity that we are speaking about. Bickering passionate couples, we're the only group to have a romantic marriage after 35 years. If they repair effectively. When Gottman is saying about repair, he means, because this word will be repeated many times, he means, okay, we, Adam and Eve had an argument about going to sending the kids to a private Christian school or a public school. We speak about how the argument went, but this is not the point now. How they repair this, how they return back to each other, how they apologize, show compassion, show kindness, it is making a big difference in how the relationship will last. So if they repair effectively, if they apologize effectively, if they connect back effectively, then this is very good. True and false. The husband should be in charge. You don't like this one. This is when you ask me, I will tell you about him. This is the research is saying. He is the life source. He sets the tone. And it is not that he is better or he is higher or the woman is lower, but this is what the research showed. You know that the first 30 seconds that each of you come, for example, Adam, we'll use Adam and Eve for making it easier. Eve is home, cooking dinner, and Adam is stepping in. The first 30 seconds that you count from Adam entering the house till he meets Eve, those 30 seconds keeps the home up. If they kiss, they hug, they smile, they show compassion towards each other, then it's a completely different life than she is complaining and criticizing him and telling him about the dishwasher is not working and the kids have attention in school and the AC needs service and the water is leaking. All of this happens in this 30 seconds shapes the whole mind. So if we are in this mindset that regardless, this is my 2 cents in this session, regardless of whatever, how is your day is, and how miserable was it, or how beautiful was it, just drop everything, connect, kiss each other, hug each other, and check on each other, and then it will be a completely different mind. In ailing marriages, couples generally communicate clearly. In ailing marriages, couples generally communicate clearly.
Like couples are not doing well, ailing?
So this is marriages on the verge of divorce. They are communicating clearly. Is it true or not? It is true. But in ailing marriages, what they communicate is?
It is negative. They communicate clearly in negative way.
So it is that. It's that profound. Most things people argue about cannot be solved. Most things people argue about cannot be solved. 69% of issues are unresolved. And this is, when Gottman found this, this finding changed the whole counseling world worldwide. What happened is he was looking to a video of Adam and Eve fighting, and he had seen Adam and Eve fighting before 5 years, because he is videotaping people's records for all these 45 years. So he said, I saw Adam and Eve before. They were fighting on the same thing. Really? Let's go back to the history. We pulled up the videos. They were fighting on the same thing. So he said, no, maybe this is just this Adam and Eve, this second couple. Maybe they researched different Adam and Eve and different couples. And Gottman separated or distributed or categorized couples in 2 categories, disasters and masters. And he calls the disasters those who are doing all the mistakes that are done, and the masters who are making it right. And he was very curious, and he said definitely then the ratio between the resolvable issues. So now 69% of the issues are unresolved. 31% are resolved. How this ratio plays and or is portrayed in the masters to the disaster. Any guess? So the couple is the key. Sorry?
You pick your but not pick your battles, but you focus on the things that are in your control. Things that can be resolved, you just accept. Things you can't change, accept.
So
the best. And the things you can't change, you're worth your time.
Okay. So if you have 100 families of masters, 100 couples of masters,
how much would be the percentages of the resolvable or unresolvable issues between the master's group and the disaster's group?
It is the same.
And this is the finding that got confirmed that flipped, literally flipped the whole counseling field
everywhere. Because simply people were going to a counselor or going to a woman to fix
a problem, which is 31% of, are you there or I lost it? So it's 31% of the issues are, okay, a Camry or a court. They had a fight, they bought none of them and they got a Mazda 6. Okay, it is resolved. But if Adam and Eve is missing and throwing his socks on the ground, once he stepped in, he takes off his shirt, throw it on the couch, the socks are on the ground, and he starts watching TV. Eve comes and looks to the socks on the ground, and she's very meticulous, very organized. 5, 8, 8 plus. So Eve, in the disasters, would be telling Adam, you know, I think you took this from your mom. She's messy as you are. And I think this goes all back to, if we have a genealogy of the people in the family, and so also your aunt and your grandma, it's very, very disgusting, but I'm just telling you that it's I can't take this anymore. What Adam would be doing, you think that your parents are clean? Let me tell you. And now what triggered everything is what? What started everything here? The socks on the ground. So those are the disasters. The master, they have the same Adam and the same Eve doing the same thing. Adam is throwing his socks on the ground, and Eve is coming, and she is seeing the socks. How she's going to deal with it is a completely different setting. For example, she would say, Lord, this is a piggy bank, Adam, and every time I'm cleaning up the socks after you, you put $1 in it. And this dollar, I will go and get my fancy bag that I'm dreaming of. Or I will go in a nice night out with my friends. We'll do whatever. It is the same issue. It is the same problem. And this is an unresolvable issue because he will continue to be messy and she will continue to be meticulous and clean. But how much they dealt with it, how much they accepted each other as well, and how much they moved forward, this is the key.
So, issues will come up. This is another weird statistics, but
if Adam and Eve are having a lot of issues, and 69% of the issues are unresolved. So Adam said, you know what? I'm out of this marriage, I will go and get married to another Eve 2. 69% of the issues. It's different issues, but it's 69 in the end. So it is very, very mind-blowing because people think when they are out of marriage that the problem is in my spouse, and when I go out, I will have a better option or I will have a better
situation, but pretty much you are carrying your 69 with you. All the time. People should not begin marriage with high romantic expectations. This is false. No, these turns out to be the best marriages hold on to romantic ideas. And research has proven this. In ailing marriages, the positive things don't erode. They are just done less and less over time. Patterns are established early and become more entrenched over time. In ailing marriages, the positive things don't erode. It is not gone, but they just are done less and less over time. Patterns are established early, become more entrenched over time. This is a tough one. When you ask
couples, usually men and women never agree on something. 100,000 couples, you separated 100,000 to 100,000 women and men, and you gave them the 10 human emotional needs. And you tell them, okay, you rank the 10 most important emotional needs for you from your husband, from the husband, the man, and the woman. Nearly all resources or all researchers prove that if you have 10 emotional needs, that the husband will pick 5 completely different than the wife.
But here, 80% of men and women say their major reasons for wanting a divorce is
definitely not loved.
They are not loved. What they feel?
Happiness.
They are not happy. They are not feeling close. They are not feeling loved. They are not feeling
appreciated.
So that's why they grew apart. And a very, 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 very nice, simple exercise that many couples can do, it's called I appreciate.
It's just you open a note on your phone and write down the date. Okay, today is March 11, 2016. And say, I, Adina Boris, appreciate so and so and so about my wife. And whatever you appreciate, I write 3 things and write them in details. Don't be, oh, I appreciate that your kindness. No. Tell me more. Tell me more details. Okay. I appreciate you remembering to collect my socks after I.
And here's a dollar.
So, the appreciation is a key in changing the mindset. Because if you keep looking on the negatives, you will be emotionally
distant, and you will be bitter, and this will add to more entanglement in the relationship. So in order to reverse this, even if I don't feel close or if I don't feel love, I can start with appreciation. I can start with doing something about it, which is, and when it is genuine, when it is honest, when it is from the heart, it makes a difference. So what are the 3 things that 80% of the people, 80% of men and women, they agreed on? What are they? They didn't feel close, they didn't feel love, they didn't feel appreciation. And a very nice homework, I'm just throwing a lot of nice tips. A very nice homework that you ask yourself, okay, honey, tell me, on a scale from 1 to 10, how much you feel loved? How much you feel close, how much you feel appreciated. And be honest, even sometimes write it down. I'll tell you a funny story. I was sitting with a couple, and I asked them on a scale from 1 to 10 how much you are committed to this marriage. And the guy said 2. And the lady said 0. She had a much better number in the beginning, but after she knew about the 2, she said 0. So I realized the hard way. So I never ask this question again unless they are answered in writing in the same time. So I give the paper, okay, on a scale from 1 to 10, tell me how much you are committed, how much. But this example, this is very simple, because how much you feel loved, how much you feel you are close, and how much you feel appreciated, measure them and ask, okay, if it is safe, don't fall in the 4 horsemen that God man realized or got all his fame because of those 4 horsemen that he realized that those are the predictor of divorce. One, he searches for those 4 things, and he adds up a couple of stuff in his mind, and he tells you, this couple is divorcing. I will show you a video about the 4 horsemen. But good, if I'm asking my wife about how much I feel loved, how much you feel love, and she said fire. Then we start fighting. Why you are feeling fire, and this is ridiculous, and how much I have given this, and I remember last one I'm talking about. So don't fall in this trap that, okay, you know, but just accept the answers, be with it, feel it, and try to work on the process. Okay, but what can I do to make you feel more close, to make you feel that you are close? What can I do to make you feel that you are loved, and what can I do to make you feel appreciated? Nice question. Who has the most influence in setting the mood in the home?
Men.
The four horsemen, those are, by the way, this is Gottman. He's a Jewish background.
Selfish.
Ugh, what an idiot.
It's not my fault we're always late.
Forget it.
Criticism, contempt, defensiveness, and stonewalling. Dr. John Gottman calls these negative communication patterns the four horsemen of the apocalypse, because they'll lead to the end of your relationship. In fact, he can predict this relationship failure with over 90% accuracy if the behavior isn't changed. So, what can you do? Well, at the Gottman Institute, we understand you might not even know you're communicating this way, or you might not know how to control it. But if you practice the following four research-based antidotes, there is hope for your future. Criticism attacks the character of the recipient, instead of focusing on a specific behavior. The antidote to criticism is to talk about your feelings using I statements. Then express a positive name.
I will pause here, because the criticism, you start attacking the person. So Eve started attacking Adam because of the socks on the ground, and she went even to the family and the mom and the. The genome and once you start criticizing a person, what will be that this person doing? You do the first. You did this. And this is the second horse. So the first horseman is criticism. The second one is defensiveness. And an antidote for the criticism is speaking about what you feel about the issue, about the socks, not about Adam or his mom or his dad, and what do you need. So I feel disrespected with every time I go home and I see the socks on the ground. I need you to help me out with this. It's completely different than this socks is like, mom and dad.
We entered in a, or you personally, or
So the I statement is a solution for the criticism.
Contempt is an expression of superiority that comes out as sarcasm, cynicism, name-calling, eye-rolling, sneering, mockery, and hostile humor. Contempt is the greatest predictor of relationship failure and must be eliminated. The antidote to contempt is to treat one another with respect and build a culture of appreciation within the relationship. Defensiveness is self-protection through righteous indignation or playing the victim. Defensiveness never solves the problem and is really just an underhanded way of blaming your partner. The antidote to defensiveness is to accept responsibility, even if only for part of the conflict. Stonewalling occurs when the listener withdraws from the conversation without resolving anything. It takes time for the negativity created by the first three horsemen to result in stonewalling, but when it does, it can become a habit. The antidote to stonewalling is to break for at least 20 minutes. Calm down, then return to the conversation. Spare your relationship from certain destruction. Learn more about eliminating the four horsemen by visiting our site.
So what are the four horsemen?
Who's more defensive? Men or women? Who's strong woman?
Contempt
is very, very toxic. Because it is not criticizing, but I'm criticizing with a lot of sarcasm. And without even the body language, when you eye roll, or when you do this with your this in itself is a lot of, this is criticism plus a lot of pride, and I'm putting the person out.
And this is their predictor in the fold when
he has a way of counting how many contempts in the conversation and multiplying the equation and tell you
this couple is divorced. So the four horsemen of the apocalypse that has been discovered by Gottman, the church every day. In the morning prayer, the Abia prayer, either praising the Lord, the Lord beseech you to walk worthy of the calling of which you have called, but loneliness, meekness, long suffering, bearing your mother and love, enabling to keep the unity of the Spirit. You need to place more effort. You need to,
when we humble ourselves, we deal with things in on a completely different level than being harsh or being mean or being or criticism or contempt or stonewalling. Stonewalling is
one of the things they found. Actually, they literally applied in the Rockman Institute is the pulse. If the pulse is above 100, then you know the difference between the right brain and the left brain? What is the difference between the right brain and the left brain?
The left brain is really analytical, and the right brain is more straight.
So the left brain is the decision, the analysis, the deep thinking. The right brain is the emotions, and it can also have the music and the creativity parts. So what we found is the ability to think with the left brain and the emotion in the right brain, they are stable. So when the left brain is stable and the right brain is stable, things is okay and you can make the right choices. The emotions and the mind is stable. But when the right brain is taking over and I'm very emotional. Now the left brain is not working and we will not be able to reason, or we will not be able even to listen. So have you ever tried to speak to a kid in your country? Did they listen to you? You never listen. It's for me, it's a not the wise choice, because already the emotions is up and you cannot reason anything. The only way I'll tell you a story. We had Sayyid doing this, I will take this from you on his hands there, and threatening them and punishing them. Things go out of control and they want to ordain this. So I took the boy outside the church. We had a nice hidden on the side stairs there. And I sat down on the stairs and I told him, you see that you are very upset. Feelings. He was very frustrated with us. And he told me, yes. I told him, how would we stop as a people? All the message, I would never be able to go out, I would never be able to help. So I smiled and told him, have you seen this? this is the only time that he reasons, because simply he's that emotion, and in order to bring the emotions down, you need to identify what is the emotion, and this is the tough part. You look upset, you look frustrated, you look angry, you look afraid. And when you identify the feeling, now you feel what I'm going through. Now you feel my feeling. And so another application for this feeling, right brain and left brain, is never take decisions when you are emotional. Never ever take decisions when you are emotional. I'll tell you a story that happened with me maybe 11 years ago. There was an issue, a big issue in the church. There was a meeting with church leaders. And the issue, and the meeting was an hour and a half from the church, so somebody who was involved in that problem called me and told me, I know where I'm going, so can I pick you up and put together? Okay, this is great. And then all the way to the meeting, because it blew out of the church, it was very busy in the meeting. Then, returning back, hour and a half, this guy didn't see anything. I didn't speak. After 2 days, I received an email, a very long and pained email, about how he felt about this meeting and action to be taken. So the first thing came to my mind is, this is because you have been in the car for an hour and a half, right after the meeting, and you are sending me an email after 48 hours? That doesn't make sense. Then I told him, what's going on? I read the email, it makes sense what you are saying, makes sense. But the whole point, I'm just very curious why you didn't say anything for in the half an hour and a half that we are driving together in the car. I know that when I'm emotional, I don't communicate. And I don't speak about what is upsetting me. I wait 48 hours, then I'm not emotional anymore. And after this, I reason, and if it really is still bothering me, then I shoot it to you that maybe this is really what I felt. And it was a long life lesson for me that I can't forget this moment, because I learned from his wisdom, I will tell you something very rare it happened, but I learned it, and it was a nice story. One day I had I was very, very upset from someone, and they drafted an email, four paragraphs, fully loaded with criticism and contempt and stole everything you can think of. Then I said, I will put it in the outbox, I will not put the name, because sometimes you put the name, sent to Father Ben, and he knows. And I didn't want to send this email. So don't put any, I didn't put anyone in the said to it, I sent it as a draft. After 48 hours, I returned back to the email. I read the first time. Second time, delete. Third time, delete. Fourth time, one sentence. Delete the whole email. It's not good. When you are emotional, You just don't do it. Simply don't do it. Many managers got really, really in a very bad situation because people were emotional. cold workplace. How many people got fired because they were emotional? And okay, this is my resignation, this is it, I'm out. Just sleep on it 48 hours and return back to the event. If it is really hurting, if it is really affecting you, then take an action and deal with it. So, my marriage is in trouble, Barbara. You ever tried communicating with a hammerhead? Stonewalling, when you are disconnected or you are very emotional, and one of the things that Gottman said is, okay, take a break, 20 minutes, and in this 20 minutes break, you don't dwell on the issue that you're arguing about. You just relax, see something funny, say a song, play a psalm, do push-ups, do whatever.
Go for a drive.
But it is agreed upon earlier. It is not okay, I'm leaving the home. No. So it is agreed upon earlier, and usually you agree upon those things in the peace time to use it in the war time. So you agree in advance. So
what happened? Bless you.
So the 20 minutes that you take as a time out, you just relax, you go in deep breathing, you don't dwell on the issue, and the other person will do the same. And when you return back, if it is too much intense, then let us restore it and deal with it in a different setting. Not to put it under the rug and pretend that it's not there, but you address it in a better moment. Happily married couples are not smarter or richer or more psychologically astute than others, but in their day-to-day lives, they have hit upon a dynamic that keeps their negative thoughts and feelings about each other, which all couples have, from overwhelming their positive ones. Happily married couples are not smarter, richer, or more psychologically astute than others, but in their day-to-day lives, they have hit upon a dynamic that keeps their negative thoughts and feelings about each other, which all couples have, from overwhelming their positive ones. And here is the example of I appreciate. Exercise is very, very powerful, very, very helpful. And definitely communicating what you appreciate about the person makes a big difference. Rather than creating a climate of disagreement and resistance, they embrace each other's needs, and when addressing partners' requests, their motto tends to be a helpful yes and rather than yes but, because we say yes but this and this and this and we end up not doing it, but say yes and I need your help in this, I need your support in this, I need this from you. This positive attitude not only allows them to maintain, but also to increase the sense of romance, play, fun, and adventure. And he calls also that happy married couples are emotional, intelligent couple. They respond to the emotions of each other quick. Time in the gym versus time in your marriage. This is a nice one. The Gottman is saying, I often think that if fitness buffs spend just 10% of their weekly workout time, say 20 minutes a day,
working on their marriage instead of their bodies, they would get three times the health benefits they derive from exercise class or the treadmill. He's really, this is science. Because a happier relationship, people are living a satisfactory, good enough marriage, they are living longer. They are more happier, they have less disease, they have less miserable outcome for their health. So I was thinking, okay, instead of going so I will end with this, because this is a video. It summarized the seven principles.
Because I don't think that we'll be able to go. We didn't even start the book.
Principle one, enhance your love maps. Happy couples are familiar with each other's world. They have a love map of one another. They know all the details about their partner's life. They know each other's favorite TV show, what their current goals are, and what stresses them out. Without a love map, you can't really know your spouse. And if you don't really know someone, how can you truly love them? To enhance your love maps, find out what you don't know about your partner by asking questions. Here are some examples. Who are your partner's best friends? Who are the relatives your partner likes least? What is your partner's basic life philosophy? And are you familiar with your partner's hopes and aspirations? It can be easy to lose sight of your love maps amongst the events in life that require your attention, such as work, family issues, and other things. But for a healthy relationship, it is essential that you know each other's love maps.
This
happy couples are familiar with it.
This homework, it is a love map questionnaire for you and your spouse. You go through. It is just very, very simple question. What is your favorite hobby or way to relax? What is your favorite food? You think that it is a no-brainer? No, but in many times, you will miss some of those questions. So the love map means how much you know each other. You know what really stresses Eve in this time. What she is really worried about in this weekend. How she is going to respond to the stressors that she is in.
As well, they have a love map of one another. They know all the details about their partner's life. Here are some examples. Who are your partner's best friends? Who are the relatives your partner likes to leave? In a positive light, then they are likely to have a bright future. If they view it in a negative light, then they are in trouble. To nurture your fondness and admiration, Gottman stresses that appreciation is essential. Write down three or more of your partner's positive characteristics along with an incident that illustrates each quality. Then read your list to each other. For example, if your partner did something as simple as doing the dishes instead of you, show your appreciation by thanking them for their kindness. The third principle is to turn toward each other instead of away. It's the little things that count. To be a happy couple, turn toward each other by showing you care. You can do this through small acts of giving your partner your full attention. Play a board game together, shop for groceries, or call each other during the day. These small acts are the basis of connection and passion. When stress and conflict comes in the way of happy couples, they will have more positivity in what Gottman calls their emotional bank accounts, which will help alleviate their conflict.
This is not in the research, but a couple of couples told me that they realized when they are, for example, Adam is here and Eve is there, and they are facing each other, and they are arguing about something. It's completely different setting there. If they are on the couch, touching each other, and they are arguing. I hope it is not going to be violent. But this far proximity that they are in an antagonistic way, it's not helpful.
Principle four, Let your partner influence you. Happy couples work as a team and consider each other's feelings and perspectives. They listen to each other and make decisions together by searching out common ground. Gottman identified that men are more likely than women to ignore their partner's perspective when tackling problems together. They exert too much power and must be open to being influenced by their partner's perspective if they are to improve their relationship. It's not always the men, though. The same message applies to women as well. For example, if you want to spend $10,000 on a new car and your partner wants to spend it on a holiday, then take a deep breath and listen to each other. Show empathy, don't criticize, and really think about your partner's viewpoint. Principle 5. Solve your solvable problems. Gottman identifies two types of problems in relationships: solvable problems and perpetual problems. It can be hard to tell the difference, but one way to tell is that solvable problems seem less intense and gut-wrenching than perpetual ones. Solvable problems are situational and there's no underlying conflict. An example of a solvable problem is: Bill and Sally agree that it's Bill's job to take out the trash every evening after dinner. Lately, he's been distracted from work obligations and so he forgets. Sally ends up taking it out herself, or the trash just sits there. In the morning, the apartment smells horrible, and so Sally is angry. This is a solvable problem. He's simply under a lot of stress at work, and it has nothing to do with the underlying relationship issues. One possible solution is to put a sign on the fridge door as a reminder to take out the trash. Problem solved. Here are 5 steps to solve a solvable problem. Number 1, soften your startup. When bringing up an issue, be calm, kind, and don't criticize. Number 2, make and receive repair attempts. When the argument is getting out of hand, let your partner know and suggest taking a break. 3, soothe yourself and each other. On your break, go for a walk, listen to some music, read, or meditate. 4, compromise. Share and consider each other's viewpoints to come up with a solution that works for both of you. 5, be tolerant of each other's faults. If there are incidents in the past that come up in arguments, identify them.
Those 5 steps are very, very important because it relates to all the 7 relations. Soften your startup when you are calm, when you are not emotional. It's much easier to reason and to speak and to talk about the issue. Make and receive repair attempts. Soothing yourselves if you feel that you are starting to be emotional. The compromising, okay, how can I help you, how we can reach a win-win setting, and be tolerant of each other's fault and not bring all the history back.
Custom and apologize where necessary. So what about perpetual problems? Well, here's an example of one. Susan wants to spend less time with Jim and more time with her friends. Jim says it makes him feel lonely. Susan says she needs time away from him. Jim seems needy to her, and she's feeling suffocated by him. This is a perpetual problem. There is a core difference in their personalities and what they need from each other to feel connected. The difference is unlikely to change, so they will have to be willing to accept and adapt to it if they want their relationship to thrive.
I will add, this was not the perpetual problems. This was the soft startup, make, receive, repair, soothe the yourself.
By him. Friends, it's for both of you.
So this was the solvable problems, how to solve it. The perpetual one, accept, adapt, and I will add here. Because when something is that keeps coming up, accepting each other, adapting to the situation and praying about it is a very, very important.
5, be tolerant of each other's faults. If there are incidents in the past that come up in pity to her and she's overcome gridlock. Gridlock is the result of perpetual disagreements where both partners have entirely different beliefs, dreams, or personalities. Josie wants to have children, Harry doesn't. Ben wants Sally to go to church with him, but Sally is an atheist. Gottman claims these issues are unlikely to be solved, but you can learn to accept and adapt to your differences. Identify and respect each other's dreams and beliefs. You don't have to agree with them, but acknowledge, listen, and show respect to what your partner has to say. Come up with a temporary compromise and thank each other for sharing. The last principle is to create shared meaning. Shared meaning will enhance your marriage by bringing you together. Here are two ways you can create shared meaning. One, create rituals of connection. This could be anything that brings you together that you do on a regular basis, such as sharing a morning routine, celebrating Easter each year by going out as a family, or eating out together once a week. And number two, work towards a common goal, such as helping the community through volunteer work or building a houseboat. And now you don't have to go building a houseboat, but it can be any goal that you both agree on that involves both of you.
So this is the whole book in a nutshell. I will end with a story. Amber Musa, the bishop of the youth, said many, many years back, and just will tell you how powerful this thing is. There was a school that they had husband and wife working as teachers, and both of them are sharing the same car going together, turning back together, but they are teaching in different classes and subjects. So one day, a third friend to the couple was walking, he parked in the car beside them, and he saw the husband slamming the door and the wife slamming her door, and he stormed outside the door and was very angry, very upset. So he went each of them separately, and he started criticizing her, and she started being defensive, and he got entangled in this issue. So he told them, can I invite myself to dinner today? He came, we ate dinner, we started speaking about the issue. It was from the 29% to 39%, they resolved the issue. And he told them, can I ask you to promise me one thing? He told them, okay, can you pray our Father after dinner together? It's not a big deal, he told them, no, but just pray with a clear conscience in front of God. So he told them what you need. He said, when you say, forgive us our trespass, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Don't lie on it. Just stand in front of God wholeheartedly forgiving and also receiving forgiveness and giving forgiveness. So are you going to promise me this? They said, yes, yes, yes. After 3 months, he checked on them. He went to the lawyer, what's going on? Nothing changed. You are still fine. He went to the wife, see, nothing changed, but you are still having arguments. 69%. So he told them, he brought them both and he told them, but I haven't seen you that angry, that bitter like the first time. They said, they replied and said, yeah, this is because of the promise that we have promised. And he said, how so? And we said, yeah, we know that we're going to pray together with the angry woman and we're going to pray about forgive us our trespasses as we forgive others their trespasses. And we tried to be really, really honest in it, and we every night we were diligently trying to, regardless who did the mistake, regardless whatever happened, we apologize, if you do apologize, I apologize, and we seek forgiveness from each other. And by this, they said, Father, this is aligning with family, pray together, stay together, and glory be to God forever and ever.